Lord God, great I am. You are living water. As we worship you this day, show us who we are, channels of your love and vessels of your grace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
All who are able, please rise and join with me in the call to worship. Jesus said, "Come to me,
all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest.
Take my yoke upon you and learn from me,
for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls.
For my yoke is easy,
and my burden is light."
Please remain standing for our opening hymn, "Make a Joyful Noise to God," which would be number 54 in the hymnals.
Thank you.
been poured into our hearts through the gift of the Holy Spirit. Trusting in God's overflowing grace, let us confess our sin.
Healing God of majesty and glory, we are thirsty for your grace. You made a way for us in the wilderness, and still in our foolishness we go astray. We hide our eyes from your presence. We do not listen to your word. We are lifeless when we ought to dance, and speechless when we ought to sing. Forgive us, O Lord. Speak peace to our fearful hearts. Strengthen our weak hands, and make firm our feeble knees as we seek to follow in your holy way. Amen.
This is the good news of God's grace. Though we are sinners, Christ died for us. Though we were enemies of God, God loved us. Once we were lost and dead, now Christ has become our life and salvation. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
Here a sheet of paper, and there is a lot of you today, so I'm going to get up and show you this piece of paper. It has a bunch of lines, a bunch of names on it. Do any of you know what this is, what this piece of paper has on it? No, not instructions. It has lots of lines, right? It has lots of names here and lots of names here. This is what they call a bracket. Have you heard that term? Have you heard that term lately? A bracket? A bracket. Well, this is the tournament bracket. There's a big basketball tournament that is going on, and all these names on both sides of these are the names of different teams. And what people do with a bracket like this is they look at a game like here, this one, Purdue and Vermont. And what people will do is they'll pick which team they think is going to win, Purdue or Vermont, and they'll put that all the way down to here in the middle. Whose name do you think goes in the middle? No, not necessarily. The person that you think is going to win everything, okay? So this is about picking winners and losers. Now, a lot of you are in school, I think, so how many of you, and you can just raise your hand, how many of you have been picked, like maybe in gym class, to be on one team or another? Or maybe in class you were picked to be on this side or that side. Has people been picked? Have any of you been picked last? I was picked last a lot. Athletics, not my thing. Does it feel good to be picked last?
No.
No, we want to be picked first, right? It doesn't feel really good when we're picked last. Well, there's a story in the Bible, in the Gospel of John, the fourth chapter, where Jesus meets a woman at a well. You know, like you put a bucket down and pull water back up. She was going to get water, and she met Jesus there. And this woman, she knew what it felt like to be picked last. She was picked last for everything. Nobody really liked her. Nobody thought really nice things of her. How do you think she felt?
Sad.
Probably very sad. Absolutely. That's why she went out there all alone. But Jesus did something special. Jesus took the brackets, like people normally think about, and he just wadded that up and threw that away. And he told her, "You are special. I pick you." In fact, he picked her, maybe for the first time in her life, picked her number one, first of all. And picked her for a very important job, and that was to tell people about Jesus, about all the things Jesus was coming to do, about all the things that Jesus would do, and how Jesus was going to save them and love them. How do you think she felt when Jesus picked her first?
Happy.
Bet she felt pretty, pretty happy. And the good news that God's word tells us is that God picks all of us. God doesn't pick winners and losers. God picks all of us because God loves us all so much. So now, before we go, we're going to pray. But before we pray, I want to remind you that we have prayer slips right here. So I want you guys to grab some of those prayer slips. And when the big kids out there put their hands up, you take and deliver those slips to the big kids with their hands up. And don't forget the big kids that are up in the balcony too, okay? But before we take those slips to people to add to our prayer chain, let's first pray to God. Please pray with me. Dear God, thank you that you don't use brackets to choose winners and losers. Thank you for loving us and telling us we're number one. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. See you guys next time. Don't forget to deliver those slips. But now we come to the time of reading God's word together. Our first reading today is from the book of Exodus, chapter 17, verses 1 through 7. The words to that reading can be found on page 59 of your Pew Bible, as well as on the screens behind me. We will read responsively. I will read the odd verses. You, the people, will respond with the even verses. But before we read together God's word, let us first pray for God's wisdom. Living God, through the reading of the scriptures and by the power of your spirit, may we hear for ourselves the good news and believe because of your word that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world. Amen. And now let us read together God's word from Exodus 17. I begin in verse 1. All the congregation of the people of Israel moved on from the wilderness of Sin by stages, according to the commandment of the Lord, and camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink.
Therefore the people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." And Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?"
But the people thirsted there for water, and the people grumbled against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?"
So Moses cried to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me."
And the Lord said to Moses, "Pass on before the people, taking with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go.
Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock at Hor, and you shall strike the rock, and water shall come out of it, and the people will drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel.
And he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah, because of the quarreling of the people of Israel, and because they tested the Lord by saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Our gospel reading for today can be found on pages 888 and 889 of your pew Bible, or again on the screens behind me, and comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 4, verses 5 through 42. Listen again for God's word. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. There came a woman of Samaria to drink water, to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water I will give him will never be thirsty forever. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where we ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You will worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." Jesus said to her, "I who speak with you am he." Just then his disciples came back. They marveled that he was talking with a woman, but no one said, "What do you seek?" or "Why are you talking with her?" So the woman left her water jar and went away into town and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. "Can this be the Christ?" They went out of the town and were coming to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, saying, "Rabbi, eat." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you do not know about." So the disciples said to one another, "Has anyone brought him something to eat?" Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. Do you not say there are yet 4 months, then comes the harvest? Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white for harvest. Already the one who reaps is receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life, so that the sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor." Many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony, "He told me all that I ever did." So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them. And he stayed there 2 days, and many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world." The Gospel of our Lord. There are texts that we hear or read or ponder, and their meaning is clear. There are texts we come to, and what you see is what you get, nothing more and nothing less. Then there are texts that we come to that are so heavily layered with meaning, so steeped in symbolism and subtly sublime beauty that we return to them again and again. We can never fully exhaust their meaning or their application. The texts that have been assigned for this Lenten season this year, especially the Old Testament and the Gospel lections, they're some of those kinds of passages. We looked at the fall of humanity and the covenant made with Abram. We just heard about water coming from the rock at Horeb. And we read together a few weeks ago about Jesus' temptation in the desert. We heard last week and read together about Nicodemus' nighttime visit to Jesus. And today we hear that story of the woman, the Samaritan woman at the well. Any one of these texts by itself would be enough for an entire Lenten sermon series, and we have this year both the fortune and the burden of hearing not just one, but hearing all of these texts and deciphering their meaning for us. It reminds us that we can never possibly exhaust all the meaning, all of the fruit, all of the living water that these texts have for us in a single reading or a single sermon. But like all of the texts these seasons, and just as this woman intimated to Jesus about having a bucket to draw water again and again and again, we can return to these texts over and over again and claim new insight, new meaning for us. So today, when we approach this text of the woman at the well, we know we're not getting anywhere near everything that could be told about this text. We're just getting a piece, a little sliver of it today, but we can return and ought to return again and again, just like we would to a water well, to have our thirst quenched when our faith journey leaves us parched. So in this way, all of these texts together, they are like the event that we are preparing for, the culmination of this Lenten season, that is Easter. We can never stop being fed by Scripture and what Scripture tells us about that first Easter Sunday, about the meaning for us, for eternal life, of what that empty tomb really means for us. And we should never think we can ever exhaust all that meaning. But rather, this is like some great divine buffet that we can return to again and again and again to feast on the words of God, and in so doing to be fed and fueled for our journey in faith that we're on. So where do we begin with this text? Where do we focus? Where do we start with this story that many of us have probably heard or read time and time and time again? I think we can start with the concept of the dare. After all, that is what is going on here. It is a dare. Now, all of us have been children, or maybe we still are children. Some of us are just leaving childhood. Some of us might have waved goodbye to that time a long time ago. But one thing all children share is daring. It's quintessentially kid. Daring one another, that is how we push each other, sometimes very stupidly and dangerously, to do things we otherwise would not do. To dare another is, for some children at least, the same thing as commanding them. You just have to do it. How can you be dared to do something and not lose face if you don't? Well, and this is to say nothing of the various types or levels of daring. There's the basic dare, I dare you. There's a slightly more intense double dare. Then there is the variant of the double dare, the double dog dare. You don't trifle with that one. But then there is the one that just beats every one of them, the triple dog dare. I triple dog dare you. I mean, how can you hear that and not be required to at least give it a shot? Now, at its basic, most basic, Jesus' first words to this woman at the well, it is a dare. And it might as well be a dare of the triple dog variety. Give me a drink, I triple dog dare you. What must she have thought when he said those words, give me a drink? Was she surprised somebody was there at that time of day? After all, she went there because no one is supposed to be there. Was she surprised that this was a man asking it of her, or that he was a Jew? Was she annoyed? Who does this guy think he is asking me for a drink? Or was she maybe fearful? What does he want? What angle is he playing at here? What's he really want from me? She had every reason to not respond to him, every reason to ignore him. She had every reason to just turn right around and go right back to where she came from. Think about it. She's considered so insignificant, she's not even named. She doesn't even have a name. Have you ever felt so insignificant that even your name, where you came from, doesn't even matter? She did. She knew what that felt like. She has no reputation, or actually, more precisely, she had a reputation she probably wished she did not. That's why she's gathering water, not in the morning with the other respectable women of town. No, she's a woman of no respect. The one everyone looks down to. The one that says, we know everything we need to know about you, and none of it's good. Forget a scarlet letter. No one needed to be informed of what her issues were. Everyone knew them. She wore them out there, and no one let her forget them. She simply had no leg to stand on at all. So in this season of March Madness, this is not just any underdog story. This is not a 12 seed taking down a 5 seed. This isn't even a 16 seed play-in team beating a number 1 seed. This is like a team that was not even invited to the NIT, that second level tournament, the one that people jokingly call the not invited tournament. This is like a team that's not even invited to that, beating the best team in the land. It is not even fair. It's not even a close contest. This imbalance, this difference in power and authority between Jesus and this woman. So given this, what shame does she have in turning around? And before we go any further to answer the question, some of you may be thinking, Louisville. I picked Louisville. And just to be clear, I have never picked a correct winner, so. But they're still playing, so we'll see where it goes. But she might have asked herself, we might ask, what risk is there in throwing in the towel, saying, I'm done, no more? There are stakes here, they are extreme. Her responses and her questions of Jesus, they reveal something curious about her, though. For this woman who seemingly gets everything wrong, she gets the basics of the God thing, of the faith thing. That shouldn't be the case. She's a woman. She's not of the right people. I mean, she's a Samaritan, after all. She's the one always on the wrong side of a bad choice. She shouldn't get it, but she does. At least in part. That's what her questions show. And it reminds us, people that are on the wrong sides of those bad choices, they often understand the right choice, the right path, what they're supposed to do. It just always seems a little bit beyond one's ability to choose that, or just outside of their reach to grasp or be capable of doing it. She knew about the social norms. This strange man should not be asking me anything. This Jew should not be asking me anything. She knew what was going on. She knew this wasn't just any man. She knew this was a prophet. She knew he had special insight, that there was something different about him that allowed him to perceive things about her, even though he had never met her. She even knew that he knew things about her own life that she probably wished she could forget. She knew about worship, about proper worship. She even knew about the Messiah, the one that would come, that would bear the title Christ. She knew about this, but she only knew in part. So the big stake for her, what is up for grabs in this contest, is moving from a little bit of knowledge to full knowledge, from taking that head knowledge into full-on lived experience of knowing in part to knowing in full. And because of it, believing. We know that's the goal of faith. That's where we are supposed to end up. But we also know, if we've ever gotten there or ever gotten at least a little taste of that, that that is a long, painful, and hard journey to take to get to that point, especially if we do not know what the final destination is. We've heard this story. We know how it ends. She didn't. But she gave up everything because there was something about him, something she trusted. Or what about the stakes for Jesus in this story? What risks was Jesus taking? Proper men, Jewish men, they did not ask things of strange, unaccompanied women. Jews did not ask things of Samaritans. God simply does not have anything to do with lowly people. Or is that so? Because this woman is an outsider. In fact, she is an outsider that breaks the mold of an outsider. But his responses to her, how he interacted with her, it holds up for us today a mirror and asks us, who's the outsider among us? Who is the unredeemable that we come into regular contact with? Who is the unreachable? Lizzie Tucker. Who is it that we discount? Who is it that we ignore? Who do we write off without even giving the slightest glance to? Jesus transcends all of these things. And if Jesus will cross all of these boundaries, will have nothing to do with keeping people separate, if he will break down these barriers, what then is our excuse? For that is the point of the dare in this story. Jesus dared the woman, but actually, she dared back, but Jesus dared first. And isn't that true of God in our lives? That before we knew we needed, before we knew we were worth it, before we could even comprehend accepting what God would give us through Jesus, God took a dare on us. John 1 reminds us, God dared to become flesh and dwell among us in Jesus Christ. Jesus also, at the conclusion of this story, apparently also dwells with Samaritans. People respectable folk aren't supposed to have anything to do with. This account at the well also reminds us that God, through Christ, dares to push through into our lives, to intrude upon our comfortable routines. When we have everything set up just the way we want it, God has the audacity to come in and say, I'm going to mess all of this up for you. This woman likely had no idea this day would be any different. And then Jesus shows up and dares himself to get involved in her life, to intrude and trespass and transgress a boundary, to reveal a deeper truth, to live out that reality of John 3:16 and 17. It's no coincidence those words come right before this account, those words that close out that teaching of Nicodemus. John 4 actually shows what those words in living color look like. What it looks like for God so loved the world that none would die, but all would have eternal life through faith in Christ. That Christ comes not to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Christ dared, most of all, the biggest thing, to send her away. But not just send her away empty-handed. He sent her back to where she came from with a mission. Something to do, even though she didn't know it at that time. But when she got there and the time and the circumstances were right, when she returned to her village and caused such a commotion, it was then that God gave her the words to speak, words that informed, words that evangelized, which really just means to tell people good news, words that motivated people to come and to see for themselves this one who told her all things, and they did come. They did see, and more importantly, they believed. God is thirsty. That is another thing we can take from this reading. Our daring God is waiting and is thirsty for us. A woman of long ago, just like that Irish saint many of us celebrated on Friday, saw in his face, in Jesus' face, the face of a stranger was actually the face of Christ looking at her, the Christ, the anointed, the Messiah. Jesus dared, but really she dared back as well, and she was never the same again because of it. She returns to her village. Maybe she was running as she got there. Maybe she was yelling, crying out, trying to get attention from anyone she passed. Maybe she rang a bell. Maybe she danced a jig. I don't know what she did. These people who probably ignored her to a fault. She did something where they listened. These ones who paid her no mind because she wasn't even worth a moment's notice. And she says, hey, there is this guy out there. There is this guy, and he has told me every single thing I have ever done. I know this might sound crazy, but do you think God sent this one? Do you think this one knows something about God? Do you think this one has a message for us from God? Come and see for yourself. See what you think. This one who told me everything I've ever done. And then words that perhaps she thought but did not say. This one who told me everything I ever did and still loved me anyway. What do you have to lose today by daring God? When we come and heed the call of Christ in our lives, we all lose things. We lose powerful things, influential things, things that we think are important to us. We lose them all because answering the call of God is not for the faint of heart. It is not for ones who do not want to be in it for the long haul. It is not for the ones looking for a very quick turnaround. Because answering the call of God, it demands nothing less than our very lives. Our lives in every sense of the word. Yes, there is a promise of what we will receive if we believe. This spring of life, this living water that gushes up, wells up in our life, abundantly pouring into our lives and beyond it. But we have to give up everything for it. This day, this season, it comes down to answering a simple question. The woman at the well answered it, and now for all of us, it is put to us, all of us, do you dare? Do you dare say yes? Do you dare draw near? Do you dare come close? Do you dare answer Jesus when he says, give me a drink? As we come to our time of prayer, of sharing our joys and blessings and our needs and concerns, a few items to lift before you for prayer. We pray for the family of John Gunther, John who passed away in Albuquerque this past Wednesday. He's the younger brother of Tony Gunther, so we pray for John's family and friends, but especially for Tony and for Barb. We pray for Maggie Tate, who left on Friday for a medical mission trip to Uganda. We pray for all of the paths that God is preparing for her and for her team even now for that country in Africa. We pray for all in our community who are ill, especially for Sharon Rogers, Mike Denning, and Steve McLaughlin. And we pray also for Ruth Bach and her great-grandson Carter, who are having some difficulties at this time. Are there other joys and blessings or needs and concerns we would lift before one another and God? For Charlie Walker, a friend of the McKinneys and who's been in ICU for over the last month. We pray for him and for full and complete recovery. Yes, Glenn. Prayer for refugees all over the world, for safe havens and for peace. Yes?
We have a joy.
You have a lot of them. Absolutely. It's great to have Bob and Irene's family with them here today, worshiping God with us today. We give God thanks for our families.
And their 60th anniversary.
Absolutely. And for a 60th wedding anniversary. Seeing and hearing no others, let us carry all of these things that are on our hearts and minds, as well as those that have already been given voice, to God as we pray for the needs of the world. Saving God, you are the giver of living water, the source of deepest compassion, the fountain of eternal life. Hear us as we pray to you. We pray for all who are thirsty, those who are thirsty for a life of meaning, thirsty for a word of grace, thirsty for a drink of water. Hear us as we pray to you. We pray for all who are weary, weary from life's long journey, weary from quarreling and testing, weary from pain and from grief. Hear us as we pray to you. We pray for all who are broken, those broken by sin and suffering, broken by hard disappointment, broken by acts of violence. Hear us as we pray to you. Living God, through your Spirit, pour your love into our hearts, your grace into our lives, your healing into our world, until the earth is filled with your glory as the waters cover the sea. And now, through Jesus Christ and in his way, we now pray together, saying, Our Father, standing for our sending hymn number 658, God is so good.
Thank you.
Friends, the hour is coming and is now here. Go forth to worship the Lord your God in spirit and in truth in all that you say and do. May the love of God pursue you, the light of Christ enfold you, and the Holy Spirit keep you as you dwell in the house of the Lord your whole life long. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.